Very good afternoon to everyone. I thank IITG chapter of TEDx for giving me this opportunity to share with you my experiences and learning with some fascinating aspects of language. Language is a defining trait of humans, which is why we tend to take it for granted. We never really give much thought as to how language really functions, how it does what it does effortlessly. But you'll be surprised to know that language has the help of many friends to make even a simple act of speaking and understanding possible. Thus, when we speak or listen, a network of interconnected mental functions are at work. Today, I'll talk about this dynamic relationship that language shares with many multiple other factors. Let's call these factors friends. So language has many friends. They are from different domains. One domain is that of the internal domain of humans, which is the other mental functions, the other, the series of mental operations that are there behind the scene. These are attention, social cognition, memory, executive control, and so on. Similarly, on the outer world, outside of our being, is the socio-cultural context. This is the other aspect, this is the other factor that also is very, very important in terms of speaking as well, making sense and being understood in a real life scenario. Now, this understanding of the dynamic relationship between language and these two different factors actually probably go back a long time. As per one theory, language co-emerged with other higher complex mental functions, complex cognitive functions. Language, the evolution of language has been, people have tried to understand in terms of the biological basis, in terms of the various cognitive basis and so on. In terms of biological basis, bipedalism, increased skull size, increased size of the carotid artery and so on have been proposed as the precursor of the development of complex cognition, which includes language. So the human brain developed to its current size and shape in its complexity much before language functions actually came into being. At a later stage, working memory, executive control, joint attention, social cognition, so on, co-emerged with language, and that too in Homo sapiens. So even though the Neanderthals had complex brain structure, they did not probably have language. So this is the backdrop that will help us understand how this cooperation really works out in real life. I will start with an example with a quote from Wittgenstein. He said, "All I know is what I have words for." So this takes us to the domain of codification. Languages help codify information about the world. In simple terms, this means there are concepts which have a name in a particular language, or a grammatical component in a particular language that helps codify a particular concept. And languages differ widely in terms of which concept gets codified and which does not get codified. Take the case of gender, for example. Languages which have a grammatical gender assign gender on inanimate objects which cannot biologically have a gender. So a simple object like bridge will have a masculine gender or a feminine gender depending on the language you speak. So the same object is feminine in German and masculine in Spanish. Similarly, the concept of time can also be different from language to language. In Chinese, it is perfectly normal to have a vertical understanding of time. You can say upper half of the day to mean forenoon and lower half of the day to mean afternoon. Again, another important aspect where languages may differ is that of tense marking. Not all languages mark tense, that is the time of the event, in the word structure. When it does not, you have to take the entire sentential context into consideration. So these are some of the differences on which languages are found, we find in languages of the world. And there are a lot of them. And these differences are basically relative to the language and its script. And all of these are embedded in the cultural context within which it is situated. Now you may say, what does this mean? Languages have differences, that is fine, but why is it important to know? It is important to know because concepts that are codified are easily noticed. So language structure has an impact on our habitual thought. So if your language mandates it to give a gender to an object, inanimate object, you will be more prone towards looking at it in a particular way. This is what it finally means. So this is something like this music. So what do you hear here? We hear only musical beats, but a military trained person will hear Morse code in this, hidden in this music. If after I have told you there is Morse code hidden in this music, you can always go back and listen to it again and identify it for yourself. But a military trained person will not need to be told. This is something already foregrounded for him. He already immediately understands, identifies that particular thing in the music. The language we speak is akin to that training. Language can direct one's attention to some aspect of an event. It helps to highlight. The purpose of language is to highlight certain aspects of a language. So it helps to highlight or foreground certain things, and simultaneously, if there is an absence of a certain codified concept, it will not highlight, it will background that particular concept. We don't always need to go back to the level of concepts. We can see this interaction, dynamic interaction between your attention and your language by using the surface structure of language as well, starting from the word level. When one begins hearing a word, multiple word candidates will be active at the same time. So for example, with the input word cat, with the arrival of phoneme cat, words such as carrot, cab, etc. are active. As auditory processing advances, the irrelevant activations will die out and gradually, finally, the target will be perceived. So recorded eye movements data show quick orientation of attention to word-related objects. The objects that are related to the word you have just heard or you are in the process of hearing in the very first 100 milliseconds, that is remarkably small time frame. So this clearly suggests that linguistic input has an immediate effect on the visual search. A very famous study that has shown this, this particular interaction in this example that we have here. The participants in this case were put through a paradigm called visual world paradigm, where they heard a sentence and simultaneously looked at a display. The display had four different objects and they had to look at the object. They look at the screen. So the sentence was pick up the beaker. So when the word, target word beaker started, the participant was found to be looking at both beaker and beetle. And as it progressed, as his comprehension progressed and he reached the end of the word, he was looking at both speaker and beaker, finally settling down on beaker. So this is exactly how your eye movements, that is your visual attention, is guided by the language structure. Similar findings have been reported from research on fictive motion sentences as well. So when you comprehend a sentence, that also makes you look at things in a different way. For example, you can describe a particular scene, static scene, in a dynamic way by saying something like, this road goes from here to there. The same situation can also be said in the way that the road is between these two points. So Guwahati-Shillong road lies between Guwahati and Shillong. Or you can say Guwahati-Shillong road goes from Guwahati to Shillong. If I give the first, second sentence, Guwahati-Shillong road goes from Guwahati to Shillong, and you are looking at the picture of a road, your eyes will be scanning the entire path. But when you hear the literal sentence that the road lies between these two points, you will not scan the entire scenario. This is how the language can guide your visual attention. Now this was about the internal friend, your attentional mechanism. Let's look at the outside friend now, cultural context, social context, and so on. Visual context, that visual representation that depict a particular cultural context, can interfere with your language processing, with a linguistic task, even when that cue has no role to play in your language processing. So for example, in yet another very well-known study, the researchers used a series of pictures, three pictures of one particular community, one particular culture, representing a particular culture, and a number of such pictures. So Elvis, Eddie Murphy and Jennifer Aniston's pictures were used to represent the American culture. Similarly, Tom Boone and Kim Clijsters and King Albert's pictures were used to represent the Dutch culture, and so on. What happened in this particular study was they had used Dutch speakers, first language speakers of Dutch who spoke English as a second language, and they were describing the pictures. The pictures were animated. Two pictures moved down, one stay put. For example, Tom Boonen and Kim Clijsters move down and King Albert stays put. Now, in this particular scenario, all these characters, all these personalities are famous people from Dutch culture. However, the sentence was in English. Now, this was a mismatch condition, and this gave a result where the Dutch language interfered in the English sentence. In the sense, Dutch words were inserted in the English sentence. This is what happened. This is how, even though the context was not overtly related to the task, it was still interfering. Similar findings were reported from studies on Chinese English bilinguals, where the faces and the pictures that have to be named were interacting. So there were line drawings, simple line drawings that the participants had to name. They had two languages and two kinds of faces which they combined. So there were Chinese face looking out from the screen, and they had to name the pictures in either Chinese or in English. Similarly, there were Caucasian faces in peeping out of the frame, and they had to name the pictures in either English or Chinese. Now, when they saw a Chinese face and they had to name the picture in English, there was a significant amount of interference, in the sense that they took longer time to name it in English. However, the effect was not so much in case of the first language. So you see a dynamic relationship, dynamic updating of information about the background and the task at hand. So this is a case where you see all the three friends interacting with each other dynamically online as you process language. However, when we carried out similar studies in Indian population, we carried out studies on Bodo Assamese bilinguals, Ausantham Naga bilinguals, and Nongme Meitei bilinguals. We did not find similar interference effect. So even when the cues were culturally very, very salient, very, very important cues like their dress, their food, their cultural items and so on, this did not interfere with the linguistic task at hand. In most cases, there was a facilitation, meaning if there was a matching condition between the context and the language, it was faster, response was faster, but there was no delay in case of mismatch. Now this brings us to yet another aspect of the outside friend. So the context, living context, the usage of the language and the communities, the interrelationship between the communities that represent those languages also make a difference. So Chinese English bilingual is not comparable to an Ausantham bilingual by no yardstick, because Ausantham bilinguals are also bicultural bilinguals. They've always lived side by side and they're used to this difference. And now you can extrapolate this to the entire Indian population. Diversity is something we grow up with. We don't really notice it there for probably. And if it is not relevant to the goal, we are able to ignore it. This is what the findings suggest. So there are all various types of studies that have tracked this kind of relationship between language and the internal world, language and the outside world, and so on. We can go on and on. However, I would like to conclude with yet another very interesting domain, that of brain plasticity. All of us know that the brain is plastic, meaning that the brain can be trained to do things that it previously did not know about. So sustained training in one mental activity trains the brain to do similar activity in many other domains. This extends to language as well. Sustained use of two languages, two or more languages, for a very long time makes our executive control mechanisms like conflict monitoring, conflict resolution, inhibition and so on stronger. How do we know that? How are we making such a big claim? This claim has been supported by data from children, bilingual children. Bilingual children have been found to be doing much better as opposed to their monolingual peers in tasks that require this kind of activity, this kind of control mechanism to be in place, whether it is conflict monitoring or resolution or whatever. Some of these tasks are Simon task, card sorting task and so on. Simon task is based on conflict resolution and conflict monitoring capacity. So, and similarly, card sorting task depends on your how quickly you update your information structure and accordingly react, accordingly act upon the new cue that has been provided to you. So children who grow up in bilingual setup, who speak two languages from early childhood, have been found to be quite adept at handling this kind of challenging situation that basically track their inhibition control, how you control your reaction with the given in terms of a given stimulus and so on. So I hope with the help of these few examples, very few examples indeed, I could show you that there is a dynamic relationship between language, whether you are speaking or hearing, with cognitive functions and the socio-cultural backdrop. Thus, it is very safe to say that language does not work in vacuum. It needs the impact, it needs the cooperation from your internal world as well as your external world. Ultimately, that's what makes us human. That's what makes us a social being. Thank you.